In this presentation, I'm going to try and show you the skills required in order to sink a cable into a plaster and block wall. In other words, we're going to chase out the fabric of the building in order that we can facilitate the cable behind the surface and install either a single or twin socket box, so the flush boxes. Could be that it's for a lighting point or a single or twin socket. The skills are exactly the same in this presentation for whatever we are chasing into the wall. So already we can see that during the first fix, the cable's been left and the wall now needs to be chased out in order to install it behind the plaster wall itself. So we have to chase out the plaster finish as best we can without damaging too much the surrounding areas. It's usually not the responsibility of the electrician to reinstate it, but it could be. Therefore, we want to leave as little over damage as possible, so only take out the area required during the chasing process. So we're going to chase out an area down the wall to facilitate the cable, and the cable needs to be further protected by a PVC capping. We'll show you how to fit that. And we're also going to chase out a single socket box. I'm just going to put it at a random height here on this wall. This wall's going to be used many times by learners, so we're trying to limit the amount of space that we're taking out. However, the skills required out there in industry is exactly the same, just perhaps the chase would be a lot longer down the wall in order to facilitate the socket outlet or lighting at the correct point. So, first of all, I'm going to offer my capping up and I'm going to make some measurements and marks against the side of it in order that we can start the chasing process, along with the single box as well. So I'm going to offer my capping up against the wall and I'm going to take a thick marker pen and mark down both sides. So, put that into position. Take my thick pen, mark down both sides. The reason I like the line to be thicker than rather than using a pen, using a thick pen in this case, is that we tend to chamfer in slightly when we chase, and therefore once the plaster and brick below has been removed, we find it doesn't fit. So by having the lines wider than the actual capping, we'll actually make the chase that little bit bigger, and hopefully that'll remove the narrowing of the chase as we go. Exactly the same on the box. Take my single box at the required height for the installation. Mine's at a random height in a cubicle here at college. And again, I'm going to mark round that using my thick pen. Okay, so the area for facilitating my capping and cable marked out, and the area around, in this case, a single socket box has been marked out. Exactly the same process if it was a twin or whether it would be a lighting box as well. So during the chasing process, I'm going to be wearing a pair of goggles. I should also be wearing a dust mask in my workshop as well. However, for part of the presentation, I may not be wearing the dust mask due to the fact I want to communicate some information to you. And I've struggled to overdub the voice before when I've heard it incorrect on the video. So if I'm not wearing the dust mask, it isn't because it's not required in my workshop. It is. It's purely to transmit the information across to you. I will also need to be using my lump hammer, my cold chisel and my bolster chisel during the chasing process itself. So first of all, what I want to do is break the finish of the plaster all the way around the line that I've marked. So I'm not going to absolutely wallop the living daylights out of it on the first part. I'm just going to break that finish on the actual plaster itself, and then we'll go in a little bit firm once we've been round and broke into it that first time. So let's see how that looks. So using my bolster chisel, going to break round, keeping to the wide lines. And then so what I've done is just broke the top finish on the plaster, and some parts have come away, but at the moment, fortunate for me, it's only come away in the area that we're going to remove and hasn't come away on the surface that we'd like to leave as reinstated as possible, so fully plastered if we possibly can these sides. Bits may fall off during this process, but at the moment we've only lost the bits that actually fall within the chase itself. So next I'm going to chase out the area in order to facilitate the single socket box. To do this, I'm going to start on one edge, in this case the left hand edge, and I'm going to chase that to what I believe is the correct depth for the box. Then what we're going to do with that area cut to the correct depth on one side is chase into the area in which we think is at the right depth. So I will start here and then chop to the gap that I've obviously created on the first part of the chase. So see what that looks like. So hopefully this left hand edge here is at the depth that I believe the box is. So in other words, I've gone down for that depth, and we're going to now chase into the part that we've actually started. So into that groove. Quarter of it out now, and I'm just checking that I'm at exactly the same depth as that first corner that I started on. And go for another. Now is tidying up the edges. What we tend to do is chamfer down slightly, so I'm just squaring this top edge and the side edges out in order to facilitate the box, so they tend to be where we curve inwards. Okay, let's see if the box fits. What we found there is a tiny bit of play, which is not a problem, but is it flush? So I'll put my chisel and hammer down. So hold it in there. It's below the surface, so it's sunk slightly below the finish of the plaster in order that we can reinstate it. What we don't want to do is have it sticking out. It's got to be flush or slightly below flush of the surface, so slightly in further or dead flush with where we are. That's the box done. I'm going to repeat the process now. The actual chase itself. To facilitate the cable and the capping, I probably don't have to be quite as deep as I were for the socket box itself. So as I take this one out, I may keep offering up the capping to see if I've got it below the surface. So just sunk it in slightly below that surface. Exactly the same process as we did before, but perhaps this time I'm not going to be cutting to an edge, I'm just going to be chasing it out as we go along. So I'll start and go across and work my way up the chase. You can already see we're popping out bits of the plaster. What we don't want to do is great swathes of plaster to be missing. These are just popping off as we go. Not a lot we can do about that. We have got to chase it out in order to get the cable under it, so we're going to have some peripheral damage as we go. We can see how we're working up there, making sure we keep the width, okay, and I'm keeping the corners clean as well. So I'm going back in and making sure I haven't done that chamfering that I said that tends to occur. I want to carry on with this, stop the video there, and we'll see it when the chase is actually finished. So we just need to confirm, as we did with the box, that the capping sits in the chase and doesn't stick out beyond the surface, in other words, protrudes. So if we lay it in there, we can see that the capping itself is below the surface of the finished plaster, and we've only lost a little bit of outside plaster here that will obviously need to be patched as well as the chase. We've done quite well by using that technique of just breaking it in the first instance that we went all the way around before we go in solid and hard with our chisel in order to remove the plaster and block. In this case, it could be brick, but in this case it is block. What I'm now going to have to do is take a little bit more out. When I position my, in this case, single socket box into position, the cable is going to enter here in this top hole, but is it blocked by this corner of brickwork here? And obviously it needs to be a little bit lower here in order that it goes into the box and doesn't crush against the top surface. So I'm going to need to take a little bit more out. I'm going to use the cold chisel for that rather than the bolster chisel I used in the first part. So I've lowered the area there, let's clear the brick dust out the bottom. When my single socket box fits in, I've got an area now that the cable can lay in and comfortably get into the pre-formed hole in the top of the box, which I'll knock out in a moment. So what I'm doing now is knock the hole out in the top of the box. It's a 20mm hole, and I'm going to put a 20mm open grommet in its place in order to protect the cable. Knock it through, pair of side cutters. Break it out, and I'm going to position my grommet in the box itself to protect the cable where it enters the metal enclosure. It's going to be positioned like so. I've got an option now, fit the box, or I can dress the cable around and fit the cap in. I'm going to choose to fit the box next. I've got my drill set up with a 5.5 masonry drill bit. I've also got round headed screws because we're fixing a metal box. Everyone in the industry is now laughing at me because they only use countersunk. At college, where we're fitting a metal box, our default position is, first of all, the screws themselves are round head, and that's what we're using in this demonstration. Notice on that, I didn't have it on hammer action. This is a thermalite block wall and didn't require hammer. If you're going into a concrete block or brick, it would need to be set to the hammer action, or maybe even be using an SDS drill rather than a standard battery drill with hammer action only. Next up, I'm going to put the plastic wall plugs into position. So I put those into the pre-drill holes. And I'm going to screw our box into position, as I said, using round-headed screws and a posi-drive screwdriver for us. We're using 1.5-inch screws here at college because we're on a block wall in order to get a decent fixing. And our box is in place. Once the box is in place, we can look at dressing the cables down the wall and placing the capping over the top. So, box fitted. Next we're onto the capping, dress the cable down. We're gonna hold the capping on using galvanized nails as well because we don't want it to corrode through once the finish has been added to the chase that we've taken out. So once my box is fitted, I'm gonna take my capping, I'm gonna offer it up into position, gonna protrude slightly out the top, and I'm gonna make a mark at the bottom. I'm going to take my side cutters and cut one side, cut the other side, break it away, and then we see it's the appropriate length. I now need to dress my cable down the wall, very similar to the dressing that we've done when we were working with cables on wooden boards. So take out all the bumps first. It's plenty long enough. Set it into the box. I'm going to leave a little hump on the top. and just dress it into position. And then I'm going to put my capping on using some galvanized nails. Probably going to find a couple in the top area and a couple in the bottom area should be enough to hold it. Clipping it to the very side edges of the capping itself in order to hold it in position. Using galvanized nails so I don't rust back through the plaster. The capping is really there to prevent the person reinstating the wall from damaging the cable. And just give it a little test. I've moved it up and down. I can see it moves freely. That means I haven't pinched it with the nails. It would be worth looking if you had and it didn't move freely. Now I was taking the capping off and just checking you haven't nailed into the cable. Pretty much now ready for it to be replastered. Probably gonna have to trim this back to length. So we can curl that into the actual box itself. Allowing for the overplaster filler. Whatever they decide to put in as a backfill into the actual chase itself. It's likely it will be probably a browning or a base coat first, followed by finish as it originally was. Okay, so that's the chase. Wouldn't matter if we'd gone for a twin box or a shallower box or a lighting circuit, the techniques are exactly the same. Key things to remember is that initial just nipping round the entire chase and the box to break the finish, just to give it that before we start hitting it too hard. And that when I chased out the box itself, I started at one side and chased into the actual side that I believe was at the right depth. Hopefully that's been some help.